So Guy and I caught up with the CEO of Honeywell Performance Materials and Technology, Lucian Boldea, and asked him about the promise of e-fuel.
When you think about e-fuel at this point, it's the more expensive alternative. But it's also the ultimate solution because basically the feedstock to e-fuel, it couldn't get any better. You're capturing the CO2 from emissions and you're using water and green electricity. So that's about as clean as you can possibly get, reducing 88% of greenhouse gas. That's the highest cost solution today. I would put that at multiples of conventional fuel, whether it's three times, four times, but it's in that range. And then SAF, normal SAF, if you wish, that might be two to three times. So that's where we are. That's not with any incentives. Once you put incentives in place, you start narrowing that gap as well. But then when you convert that into a per ticket price, it doesn't really change dramatically the equation of choosing to fly on a plane. And when you add to that reducing greenhouse gas emissions by 88%, it becomes very compelling.
Lucian, good morning. It's Guy. Last time I checked, the numbers were daunting in terms of the scale required to get airlines to their 2050 targets. The number I pulled out was 17.5 billion gallons of sustainable aviation fuel are going to be required by 2050. How far away are we currently from achieving that kind of scale, and how quickly can your kind of technology get to that kind of scale?
Yeah, and that gets at the heart of why we're here. It's a great question. And where we are today, really, all the technologies, all the announcements that have been made really amount to about 5% of the total demand. And as you pointed out, by 2050, several governments have a target either to get to 100% or at least to majority SAF being used, and we're at 5% today. The limitation is feedstocks, and it has been historically. So we started out with fats, oils, and greases. Honeywell was the original inventor of that technology. If you exhaust all the fats, oils, and greases that are available today, you might be able to get to 10% by our estimate of the total SAF requirement. We announced last October ethanol to jet, so you can use ethanol. That gets you another 10 to 15%, so now you're at 25%. We have woody biomass technology as well. You can get another 15% from that if you convert. But then ultimately, you need the abundant feedstock called carbon dioxide. That's the ultimate solution. That's really the only way you can get to that mass balance, to the long-term goal.
But in order to do that, you have to have an awful lot of renewable generating capacity to A, drive the carbon capture, and B, split the water. That's where the limiting factor appears to be when it comes to your technology. How much of a scale-up is going to be required to provide the energy feedstock effectively to make your technology work?
Yeah, it's a dramatic scale-up. So if you look, the technology that we're announcing now and the investment that's being announced with HIF this week, that represents 11,000 barrels. So it does represent a pretty small amount. So it's 0.15% of the total demand. So you need six of these for every 1%, 60 for every 10%. So you can scale the math from there. So it's a pretty significant number of these that are required. But again, the scale will get bigger, and then also the amount of renewable energy.